Welcome into my four biggest investments, January 2018 edition, guys. Now, this new series, it's taking the place of four stocks I'm buying. It has ended. Four stocks I'm buying series, which I started over a year and a half ago and has changed trends around the three stocks, three cryptocurrencies. Like, people are doing three everything now or four of everything. I changed the whole game with that and I've decided to kill them off. The main reason was I felt like the name could be deceiving. The whole three stocks I'm buying, four stocks I'm buying, that implies that I'm actually always buying those shares during that upcoming month. But what if I don't buy those shares during the month? Does that make me a liar at that point? What if I go ahead and I actually start selling some of those shares during the month because I have a change of heart a few weeks in and I'm like, you know what, this one's jumped all of a sudden 10%. Now, you know what, I want to start exiting the position. Then does that make me like an extra liar and things like that? And what if I buy five shares in this company, but I buy 1,000 shares of this company, but this one company, the new investment, it's a very small investment compared to my huge investment. Should I really talk about that one over this one? I think the name was just confusing overall, which is why I changed it to my four biggest investments in the stock market. Guys, it's not as catchy, I know, but you know what? I'd rather it be understandable and you know, you can understand what I'm talking about going into a month because these are my four biggest investments. So hope you guys enjoy this today. We're getting into it. And by the way, check out my stock market investing mastery course. That's a first link down there in the description. If you're in your first year of investing, that course will help you out tremendously. That goes into everything I look for in a stock. Let's go ahead and get into this, guys. eBay is coming in here at number four. This is my fourth biggest investment currently. eBay, as many of you guys have probably used a platform several times to buy or sell things. They also own things like StubHub and things like that. You guys can pause the video if you want to read more into the description and see what their business is about if you don't already know it. So this is a growth company right now. It's a strong single digit growth company. It's kind of the one in my portfolio that I just like it because it's consistent play. If we look here, they expected the current year around 6.5% revenue growth, next year somewhere around 7% revenue growth. That's a strong single digit growth company, okay? And then if we look here on their income statement, you know, the past few quarters, it's just very consistent. Look at that, $2.3 billion in revenue, then $2.2 billion, then $2.3 billion, then $2.4 billion, very consistent numbers in that revenue line. Look at the gross profit quarter after quarter, $1.8 billion, $1.7 billion, $1.7 billion, $1.8 billion in gross profit. eBay is just a very consistent company with strong single-digit growth, and it's just one of those names I really like. It's one of those names I just have to have in my portfolio. Also, very good balance sheet. You know, they do have a lot of debt, but if we look here, $1.7 billion in cash, $4.2 billion in short-term investments, $6.3 billion there in long-term investments. So that's, if you add all those up, that's over about $12 billion there. And then they do unfortunately have about $9.2 billion in long-term debt, but still the cash investments way outweigh those debts there, and they're an extremely profitable company, so they have no problem paying their bills. If we look here on a forward PE basis, it's just under a 17 right now. So when I look at this company, I'm saying to myself, okay, I'm getting a forward PE on a company that's a pretty safe company, that's a single digit growth company. Like what am I missing here? This one just makes sense for me. And then also this past summer, they authorized an additional $3 billion stock repurchase program, which will obviously help out EPS over time, guys. So this one to me is just a no brainer. You're gonna give me eBay at a 17 forward PE with strong single digit growth, I'm gonna buy it every single time. Cirrus Logic comes in here at number three. Cirrus Logic here at number three. This one, they do a lot of audio components. They're kind of like, in my opinion, they're the best audio component maker out there for smartphones, tablets, and things like that. A lot of the devices that are super popular. This is a breakdown of the iPhone 7 here, just to kind of give you an example of some of the chips they make and whatnot. They're a semiconductor company. We see here they have the audio codec in there. They also have multiple amplifiers in this iPhone here. They have a lot of different things like that as far as audio amplifiers, things that run your voice through them and all the kind of things, guys, for the speakers and whatnot. They do also have Samsung as a customer. They do have a pretty decent relationship with Samsung, but they are not in the main Samsung devices yet, the flagships, meaning the Note, what are they on now? The Note 8 or whatever, and the Galaxy S8. They are not in those yet. That is a huge potential win out there for Cirrus Logic if they can get to a point where they have Samsung as a customer, guys. It's not something I'm definitely counting on on as a shareholder and someone that's just started buying back into Cirrus Logic. By the way, I've had a relationship on and off with Cirrus Logic. I've held this stock multiple times. First time I held it, didn't really make crap for money. The second time I held it, I made probably the second or third most money I ever made on a stock in my life. And now I just started buying back into this one recently. Right now, just to kind of give you guys an update, it's a company that has had super strong growth, and we'll look at that here in just a second, but they shouldn't have much growth at all this year and next year, okay? So there shouldn't be much growth, and probably in about 2 to 3 years from now is when the major growth should start again. Now, balance sheet-wise here, unbelievable balance sheet, and you guys know how much I love an unbelievable balance sheet. Cash and cash equivalents of $180 million, short-term investments of $15 million, $133 million in long-term investments, and they have no short/current long-term debt, and they have no long-term debts at all, guys. So they just load it with money, super profitable company, and they also have no debts. That's fabulous there. If we look at the revenue here, it was pretty consistent the 2015 and 2016, and then they jump up huge here. They jump up huge in 2017 to $1.5 billion in total revenue there. And then if we look at what the actual net income did there, it nearly doubled up there, guys. A double up in net income there. So they had a fabulous growth year with Apple being their main customer and Apple having a few more chips in the new iPhones than they used to have, basically. So the company right now has a forward PE under 11. A forward PE under 11 when most in the semiconductor space are trading in the 20s, 30s, and plus. This one's at an 11 currently. Main reason it's at an 11 is one, because there's not going to be huge growth over the next year or two, but not just that, because they're still heavily reliant upon Apple. Until they really get Samsung as a main customer, which honestly, if you're in the smartphone game, there's two companies that are important to you as a semiconductor company, Apple and Samsung. Everybody else is like almost non-existent because they move so few units compared to Samsung and Apple. So if Cruise can get Samsung as a main customer again, that will help out their valuation in a huge way, not just because they'll become more profitable and revenue will go up and all that kind of stuff, but because people will view this as, Apple's not 80 something percent of their revenue now, Apple's maybe 60% or 50%, and then Samsung's 40% or something like that, and everybody else is another 10%. Now, if we look here, still pretty strong guidance here for the revenue. They guided at their midpoint for $530 million in revenue. 523 is what they did last year. Cruise usually sandbags, so they should be able to hit that pretty easily based upon historically what Cruise does. They always kind of sandbag. That way they can come in and beat the numbers and whatnot. We look here, headcount has had nice growth over the last year or so. They're up to over 1,500 employees now with this company. The reason they have to add that more and more headcount is because obviously they have more and more revenue coming in, more and more profits, and they have a lot of more things they could go after, not just with Apple and expanding content with Apple, but Samsung and all these other companies that they kind of want to expand their business with, that they're not even expanding. They can't even pursue a lot of these opportunities of audio chips and a lot of devices because they just don't have the manpower to do it. Apple alone takes up hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of employees at Cruise are dedicated just basically to Apple because Apple's such a big customer. Now, if we look here also, they have a big share buyback. They just bought $50 million in shares back in this past quarter. They still have about $80 million remaining on the share buyback, so that will obviously help out EPS over time. So this one, super low PE, phenomenal balance sheet, phenomenal relationship with the main customer you want to have a relationship with in the semiconductor space, which is Apple. They do have a relationship already with Samsung. They're just kind of looking to expand that. Also, some huge growth vectors a few years out with voice biometrics and things like that, guys. So a very exciting company with Cruise, and they're still expected to have single-digit growth this year, this upcoming year, which is fabulous. Now, number two, a good old GoPro. This is my second biggest investment currently going into January 2018. This is a company that I'm basically having to pay $1 billion for. So if you buy this stock, you're paying $1 billion for the company, all right? Forward PE of just over 17 right now, which, they've been a very fast growth company. This past year, they had a very nice growth year. Now, this current year, they're expected to have grown around 11.5%. Next year, around 7.4% growth, so that's very strong there. You're getting the number one player in the action camera space, okay, which they just came out with Hero 6 a few months ago. you're getting the number two player in the drone space, and you're getting what will probably be the number one player in the virtual reality over capture space, because from what I have seen and from what tech reviewers have reviewed this product, it's been a lot of good said about it as far as this is the premier product as far as the hardware and the software matching. I remember I watched a video just this past week that a guy came out with iPhone or something like that his name is. He usually hates on GoPro products. He even said that this was the best virtual reality product as far as the hardware software he has played with and seen yet, guys. So a lot to be excited there as far as you're getting the number one action player, you're getting the number two drone maker, and which is going to have their second model more than likely come out, you know, in 2018, and you're getting what will probably be the number one virtual reality maker out there. That's pretty exciting here. Now, I want to talk about discounting for just a second here, guys. So there were some discounts GoPro was doing throughout the holidays. So there's a couple of ways we could look at this. One is, you know, GoPro just wasn't selling good. You know, GoPros weren't selling good. They got a discount on, they got a slash of prices. We saw a lot of sales going on a GoPro, you know, some at Best Buy, some at Amazon. I think those ones are probably more planned out. Those are probably more planned sales. However, I did receive emails, and people received emails that have bought GoPros in the past of like, you know, get it and get 25% off and you give this code to a friend and family. That could also be planned, or it could be sales were just weak, okay? We could say, you know, sales were weak and it just weren't good and they needed a discount. It's possible. I don't know for sure. I track sales on Amazon's best sellers list as far as electronics, and I can tell you the Hero 6 and Hero 5 were not nearly as high as they used to be. As far as like the GoPro Hero 4 and the 5, around Christmas time of year, they were usually in the top 25. This year, they had trouble cracking the top 50. Amazon has added more products to that top electronics category, so that does hurt it a bit. But at the same time, I'm not 100% convinced that sales were as strong as past years as far as strictly for those action cameras. However, we don't know. There's no way of knowing until the next quarter's reported. But there's another way to look at this. The two main cameras they were discounting on was Hero 5, which is still a $399 camera. They never lowered their price on that. And the other main camera they were doing the discounts on was the Hero 5 Session, which was still $299. These were the same prices they charged when they came out last year in 2016, guys. So when these were announced in 2016, those were their prices. And going into this holiday season, 2017, they were still at the same prices. So maybe GoPro just went with the philosophy, which in my opinion is probably a good philosophy, and I probably would have went with it. Let's not come down on the prices. Let's keep them at that, but those slash the prices come holiday season so people feel like they're getting a sale. And that's what they did. You know, they brought this down to basically after the discount, sometimes it was around $199. This one came down to $299. And it's definitely a way you can increase sales because a lot of people are wired like, in order to go out and buy something that's a non-necessary thing, like an iPhone or a new Samsung or something, that's almost like people feel that like that's a need type thing. A GoPro in many instances is kind of like a want type thing, okay? So you lower the prices by saying a sale and people feel like they won. But if you keep it just, you lower this price right off the bat to $299, $199, and then you don't see the sales there, what do you end up having to do? Then you have to discount and also bring this one down to $199, and then what do you bring this one down to $149, maybe $99 or something like that, and you start getting silly prices, guys, where your entire profit margins eroded. I can almost guarantee you with the Hero 5, even if they bring it down to $299, they're still making a fabulous profit on that. Same thing with the Hero 5 Session, guys. Even if they bring that down to $199, the other one down to $299, there's still a lot of profit to be made. But if they had to bring it to $299 to $199 and $199 to $149, then all of a sudden the profit starts going away very quickly, guys. So that's kind of where I'm at with the whole discount thing, which I got a lot of questions about that in the comments section and whatnot, and kind of my feelings on that. And then the last thing I kind of want to talk about here with GoPro is Mr. Woodman, okay? So it's always hard for me to trust Mr. Woodman going forward because he's made a lot of mistakes in the past that I feel like were, you know, him as CEO, he's a figurehead. I think a lot of those mistakes have fallen on him. However, I will say in the last 9 to 12 months, specifically really the last 9 months, last three quarters, this company has been run much, much better, okay? Since they announced that the new guy CJ came in and kind of took off over the chief operating officer, the company has just been run much, much, much better since then. So leadership is being improved, but I don't still 100% trust GoPro's leadership, which is why I'm still not buying any new shares, even though it's in the $7 range. And even though I have all those things that I'm really excited about, I'm just holding my shares because I've gone so big in this in the past, and I've gotten burned so bad that at this point in time, management still doesn't have my 100% trust, which is why I cannot buy new shares in this one. I'm just holding the ones I do in the option contracts that I do have currently. So that's that one. And Wynn Resorts, otherwise known as Winning Resorts, comes here at number one. So as you guys probably know, if you've ever been to Vegas before, they have two resorts out here, the Wynn and the Encore. They also have two resorts. Well, actually have three resorts in Macau. One's called the Wynn, one's called the Encore, and one's the brand new one that just opened last year called Wynn Palace, a absolutely amazing resort, probably the creme de la creme of any resort out there. Revenue growth, they're expected in this quarter to grow at least 20%. Current year, they've grown around 38%. Next year, analysts have this company as only growing 6%. I don't see it. I see it growing at a much faster rate than 6%, guys. I think that's extremely low, extremely low. Reason being is Macau is on fire right now, and not like in a bad way, in a very good way. Macau December GGR growth is expected 400 basis points plus above forecast, Nomura is saying. This just came out a couple weeks ago here. So year-on-year growth in December casino gross gaming revenue in the Macau market could be at least 400 basis points above the range suggested by the market estimate service Nomura. Such growth could be 20 to 25% up here, guys. That is absolutely phenomenal. Phenomenal news for Wynn Resorts. They capture much of the high end of the market, the VIP business and whatnot. As more and more customers come in, they kind of get to push the ones that aren't big spenders out of the way and have more and more of that VIP type clientele, guys. And that VIP clientele is ridiculously profitable because you're talking about people that are spending hundreds of thousands, if not millions and millions of dollars every night when they come into town to gamble and things like that, guys. And we know the house is going to win the majority of the time. So that's really, really good news for Wynn. And we're looking at a company here with a forward PE of around 25, which obviously is a little above what the market's trading at right now, but it's not much more. And for a company that, in my opinion, they should easily be able to grow 10% plus in revenues next year, if not 20% plus on the bottom line, I see no reason why that can't happen, if not more than that. So when I look at this company, I'm looking at analysts, I think, have way underestimated what revenue will actually go up next year, guys. And that's why I'm so excited about Wynn. Now, Wynn is a position I will probably be exiting throughout 2018. I've shared that with you guys, I think, a couple times on here. I believe I will kind of exit that position out, but for now, I'm mostly holding, and then I'll probably start selling, once it gets above this $170 mark, and probably start getting out of my position fully if it approaches a $200 plus mark, guys. So anyways, I hope you absolutely enjoyed this today, my four biggest investments going into January 2018. Make sure if you are a beginner in the stock market or you're somewhat new to the stock market, you want to know my exact strategy, click that first link in the description. That's my Stock Market Investing Mastery course. Even has a private email address so you can contact me if you have any questions in regards to the course. Thank you for watching, guys, and have a great day.